Obviously, one of the most important parts of any game is the graphics. In fact, a lot of time is spent online discussing whether graphics, gameplay, or story are the most important part of a game. Whether it's better to have a 100-hour game with mediocre graphics, but a killer story, or a 4-hour extravaganza with generic gameplay. And this isn't a new question either. It's been asked since Sierra first released their graphical adventure games, versus Infocom's text-based adventures like Zork. While today the answer is no less clear, what is clear is the graphics.
That's a graphics joke. Thanks for subscribing.
The question of what is the first graphics card is sort of a difficult one. There's a couple of contenders, and it really depends on how you define graphics card. Let's look at that definition, the cards themselves, and see if there's a good definitive answer. The most common answer is the IBM Monochrome Display Adapter, or MDA, released originally in 1981. Seen in devices such as the IBM 5151, this system would display text characters on a monitor. It could show off several variations of text, and had access to 256 characters. But similar to making artwork in YouTube comments, it was entirely based on ASCII art. You couldn't affect individual pixels. More importantly, this is not a discrete card separate from the CPU. Instead, it's a digital to analog converter mounted on the motherboard itself. So I think we can safely discount this as the first true graphics card, but it's notable nonetheless. Similarly, the IBM ISBX 275 from 1983 is commonly pulled up as well. And while this one could actually display lines, circles, rectangles, and could be controlled, it's still held back by the fact that it was a converter mounted by a manufacturer, not a separate unit. In 1986, ATI, a Canadian semiconductor company that worked with IBM and Commodore to produce their integrated graphics, decided to introduce their own separate device, the ATI Wonder. This is probably the first product that looks like a graphics card. If you showed this to someone today, they can probably identify it. ATI was purchased by AMD in 2006, and the brand lasted until 2010. So it's entirely possible you have used an ATI card, or at least know the brand well enough that you could see this and immediately identify it not only as a graphics card, but as an ATI. Additionally, this is the first card that allowed for multiple monitors and even multiple graphic formats and resolutions. However, once again, this card was not a wholly separate processor and required the CPU to do a lot of the calculations. A short 9 years later, an upstart company by the name of Nvidia would release their NV1. A graphics chip that could run both 2D and 3D graphics, and was developed in conjunction with Sega for the Sega Saturn. Specifically, the NV1 allowed for Sega Saturn games to be played on a PC, and at one point the NV1 and NV2 were being developed to be included as the graphics processor inside the Sega Dreamcast. As you might have gathered from that wording, it was not, and of course the Dreamcast itself was never the hit console that it was expected to be. As a random aside, the Dreamcast was a really, really advanced product, and not only did it have this very cool technology in it, it also had a built-in modem for online play, something you wouldn't see in other consoles until the slim PS2, PS3, Xbox 360 generation. The question we should ask here is, what is a graphics card? What is the definition that we can use? And thankfully, this is somewhat uncontroversial. A graphics card is a discrete expansion card, not built in, which generates a 2D and 3D output to a display. By using the term generates, we should be clear that the card itself must do the processing and render the graphics and hardware and not offload it to a CPU. So that's it. Obviously, it's the NV1. That's the first graphics card. So why isn't this more widely agreed on? Well, the NV1 was a failure, and the chip itself was barely propagated, but obviously failure to sell doesn't negate the fact that you're first. However, there are two things that does prevent this from being the obvious answer that it seems to be. First, the NV1 was integrated with a Sound Blaster sound card and a 15-pin built-in Sega Saturn compatible joystick port on a single card. This means it wasn't really a graphics card, it was a multimedia card. Secondly, though less damning, the NV1 didn't use any of the industry standards. Most graphic cards at the time, in fact basically all of them, used triangles to create polygons and used these polygons to represent things. The NV1 went in a different path, using quadratic texture mapping, or quads, essentially using squares instead of triangles. While this may not sound like a big deal, it was a major mistake and frankly almost killed Nvidia, especially when Microsoft released DirectX and standardized the industry with triangular polygons. Squares are harder to design for. They are less simple because they're not automatically flat. They're harder to arrange into curves and exotic shapes, and in all ways generally considered a more complicated, less efficient, less smart way to produce games. These two things combined made the NV1 a failure, but do they remove it from contender as a first graphics card? I think yes, simply because this would be like saying a train is the first car because they both use wheels. Trains are more complicated, having more features than just transportation, and use a different delivery method, rails versus road. No, it's not exactly perfect, but hopefully the meaning is clear. The NV1 isn't quite the first graphics card. Perhaps the name you thought of when you clicked this video was Voodoo. And in 1996, a company named 3DFX released the Voodoo Graphics PCI, today commonly called the Voodoo 1. Let me say immediately that the Voodoo 1 is not the Voodoo that everyone commonly thinks of, that's the Voodoo 2, and the Voodoo 2 is a remarkable piece of equipment as well. However, neither of these would qualify because neither of them could create 2D graphics. In fact, you had to have a separate 2D graphics card. The Voodoo and Voodoo 2 would only render 3D graphics. So if it's not the MDA or the ISBX or the Wonder or the NV1, and if it's not the Voodoo, what could it be? There are three possible choices left. In 1986, Texas Instruments released the TMS 34010, the first programmable graphics processor, a 32-bit graphics-oriented processor which allowed for drawing bitmaps and pixel-by-pixel image creation. It was used in dozens of video games in arcades, from NARC to Mortal Kombat to NBA Jam. It was used itself as the basis of other video cards, coprocessor boards for Windows and Unix, and more. The 34020 was capable of 3D graphics, and TI courted Nintendo and Sega, seeking to create a 3D console in 1988, and even introduced a wholly separate adapter card for PC gaming in 1987. However, I believe we can disqualify the TMS because of the fact that it was designed to be a CPU and could run general purpose code. It's not a graphics card, it's just capable of being one. In 1975, MOS technology employee and computer pioneer Chuck Peddle would head the design of the MOS 6502, a processor which would go on to power the Atari 2600, the Apple I and II, the NES, and more. It changed the way processors were created forever, inverted the failure rate of processor production from 70% failure to 70% success, and democratized computing by introducing a $25 competitor to what was, at the time, a $300 standard. Chuck Peddle was a former Motorola engineer, and to be clear, this is the same as if you could buy a top-of-the-line Samsung or Apple smartphone alternative from former Samsung and Apple employees for about $80 instead of $1,000. It was a pretty big deal, and many gamers from consoles, Commodores, Apple, and PC earned their stripes in the trenches of early gaming history on a 6502. But it too fails our definition. It's not a graphics card. It's just capable of being one. That leaves a single contender left standing. I'd love for you to consider joining me on the Discord. You can join by typing in crymore.tv/discord, all lowercase, or clicking in the description. In 1999, Nvidia released their GeForce 256. What separates this card from all others is the simple fact that with the release of the 256, Nvidia had created a card which no longer required the CPU. Finally, a standalone discrete expansion card, not built in, which renders and processes 2D and 3D output to a display independent of any CPU. The GeForce 256 not only created the still-standing GeForce brand, but it also finally took lighting and transformation into the graphics card. These two things were the last holdouts from the 3DFX cards, and the various competitors released even by NVIDIA itself. With the GeForce 256, everything was rendered by the card. Additionally, you can make a sneaky second claim that this is the first GPU, because NVIDIA made that term up. GPU was a marketing term created by NVIDIA, and they defined it as a single chip processor with integrated transform, lighting, triangle setup clipping, and rendering engines that is capable of processing a minimum of 10 million polygon. Obviously, this is marketing talk designed to not accept any competitors into the term terminology, and to set a standard which their competitors would have to meet in order to be competitively viable. The 256 wasn't a huge seller, it didn't set the world on fire, but it was the first fully discrete graphics card, and it did create the term GPU. The technology on board wasn't particularly standardized, but it became standardized later thanks to the success of later GeForce cards and the necessity of competitors to be able to be called GPUs. And this card was supported until 2006, simply because of how future-proofed the architecture was. So the question then becomes, is it the TMS 34010, which was used as a graphics accelerator and processed things independently, allowing for fully programmed graphics, but which was designed as a CPU first and foremost? Or is it the MOS 6502, which created the computer revolution and powered most of gaming's most iconic images throughout all of the most influential time periods, but which also was not designed to be a graphics card? Does NVIDIA hold the claim? Because of the GeForce 256 and its position as the first independent card with no ties to a CPU. Plus, you know, they came up with the whole GPU term. It comes down to definition. I think by our definition, the GeForce 256 wins. But my heart says the MOS 6502 was clearly the winner because it was the first to power games. And my brain says the TMS 34010 because it was the first graphics processor. Let me know what you think, and maybe we can reach a consensus. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider sharing it on Reddit and liking the video. It really helps us out, as we are small creators and every single individual share really makes a difference. Of course, feel free not to. If you'd like to watch another video, there's one on the screen right now, and as always, we'll see you on the next one.